Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming to the to the agents panel. It is 10 o'clock. Is everyone having a good time? Everyone had a good time this weekend? Wonderful. Well, I am very pleased to announce that I will be joined momentarily on stage by agent extraordinaire, wonderful chap. He is responsible for bringing many of your favorite voice talents on stage. I beg your pardon. He's responsible for bringing many of your favorite voice talents to the convention. He has been active in the industry for many, many years. And he will be chatting with me, and then we will be taking some questions from the audience. If folks have questions about the industry, or really about any facet of the voice acting world, he is a wonderful resource. I'm just waiting for my cue here. Ah, there we go. Agent extraordinaire, magnificent gentleman. 9876. The one, the only, Agent Ralph Strike.
Hello. You can tell that I don't work on this side of the mic very much.
His voice is just that powerful, it blows out the whole thing.
Exactly.
Thank you, AV staff, by the way, for that. We had to get the James Bond theme for you.
That would be a good one.
Well, I mean, it's Agents in Black, so we could have done with Men in Black.
That, and now I'm wearing everything but black.
I've got some shades I can lend you if you need them. Yeah. We'll have someone bring them up. Anyway, Ralph Strike, so you are an agent.
Yeah, and a lot of people really don't know what that means. So in essence, what an agent does is I am sort of the in-between and the person that can hire you.
Oh.
The person that can hire you and the talent. So for example, My Little Pony, when the producer would send me the original script that had all of the breakdown of all the characters that they were looking for. And then based on that, I suggest to them who I think is appropriate for the role. So from the show, I represent Tabitha Andrea, Kelly Sheridan, who does Starlight, Princess Ember, Shannon, Kazumi, Marika, Kelly Metzger, Peter New, Claire Corlett, Ian Corlett. So I've been fortunate enough to sort of have a connection with the show, and a lot of my people work on it. So when the breakdown comes through, it would describe Pinkie Pie and Rarity and all of the characteristics that we know, and then based on that, I think of the talent that I have on my roster that I think could do those voices. And we've got a studio in the office, so there's several ways that they can do it. One, I bring them in and we audition them in our studio, and then I send the producer MP3s of their auditions. In the case of My Little Pony, they would look at the people that I suggested and then they bring them into the studio, and then Terry Klassen, who's the voiceover director, would direct them. So then at that point, once the client gets the job, then my job is to negotiate how much they're going to get paid. And everything that we do in Canada falls under a union agreement, just like it does in the U.S. And then once we agree on what they're going to get paid for the show, then pretty well at that point what I do is I schedule them. In a show like My Little Pony, we record every Wednesday morning for about half a year. So that's sort of my job as an agent. So the producer contacts me, says, who do you think is right for the project? And then I suggest who I think is right, and then they go from there.
And this takes place quite a long time before we as an audience end up seeing the episodes.
Oh, yeah. I mean, an episode that, let's say the episode that's going to record this Wednesday, probably won't come out for about a year, year and a half. Yeah, I mean, we laid down the voice track for the feature film more than a year ago. And, it's coming out, I think, in October-ish, end of October. So yeah, there's a huge process.
Folks excited for that, yeah? Also, if you want to kind of move up, you're more than welcome to.
If we want to have more of an intimate space, especially when we're doing Q&A, I mean, here's a perfect opportunity for anyone that is interested in getting the voice agency world to ask, really candid questions, and hopefully I'll be able to answer them for you.
So I'm curious, we sort of ask the voice actors a lot, how did you first become involved in the world of voice acting? What drew you to the industry? How did you first get involved in your role in all of this?
I'll give you sort of the Reader's Digest version. I had a scholarship which paid for all my university, and My parents are German, so they said, you're going to be a doctor. I went, okay, that's what I'm going to do. So I started majoring in biology with a minor in calculus. And my roommate at the time was getting his BFA, so Bachelor of Fine Arts, at UBC. And through him, I was meeting all of these really creative people. And I realized, wow, this is way more interesting than being a doctor. And then one of the people that I met was working for CBC, which is kind of like your ABC, NBC. It's the Canadian Broadcasting Company. And he was working in casting, and we became really good friends. And he was doing extras casting, so he said, do you want to do extra work on a film? And I thought, well, that would be great, because I can study and kind of go on a set. And I did that, and then through that, I met Richard Lucas, who owned Lucas Talent. And this would be back in 1991. And I came up with an idea, approached him saying, no one at the agency really represents people for voice. We had people that represented actors for on-camera commercials, and then, of course, agents that represented actors for theater, and then, of course, for film and TV work, but no one really did voiceover. So I kind of came up with a proposal, and he said, yeah, let's give it a try. And I worked there up until 2007, then myself and my three partners formed RED, which is sort of Ralph, Elena, Deb. It's the first initials. And we've been doing that since 2007. And we've got a great houseboat in Vancouver.
Now, does your agency currently just represent voiceover work, or do you also now work in the theater and the film and TV world?
Yeah, I just represent people for voiceover work, so and for TV, radio commercials, animation, I mean, pretty well anywhere where you hear a voice, you know, the GPS in your car, you know, when you call information, you know, in Vancouver it's 411 and you ask where, you know, Joe's Pizza. To transit, I had the voice for the opening closing ceremonies of the Olympics that were in Vancouver 2010. The medal ceremonies. Then we have four agents that represent actors for film and TV work, and then an agent that represent people just for commercials.
So voices that you wouldn't necessarily think about, like you said, the opening and closing ceremonies, and
you know, but you hear like the GPS in your car. You know that you know, and so many places. If you call Best Buy or you're on a hold system, and you've got that prompt, you know, press one to do this, press two. When you call an airline, you know, the same thing. There's a voice that they need to, you know, a pleasant voice, ideally, that will sort of, you know, when you're on the on hold message, the person that you're listening to.
The voices you never actually want to be hearing for hours on end.
It's, you have 45-minute wait.
Apparently, Ellen McLean, voice of GLaDOS, and also voice of one of the AIs the AI in Pacific Rim, was wandering around the convention earlier this weekend. Did folks hear about that? So, there is voiceover talent everywhere, hiding. Just fun, random fact. excuse me. So, oh, goodness gracious, it's Sunday. My voice is destroyed. I'm sorry. Yeah. That's a good one. What are the tips and tricks for sustaining your voice when you're having to do a lot of talking?
I mean, most of my performers, if they have a really busy day, it's sort of vocal rest. Then the day before, they won't do a lot of talking. You know, of course, they'll go to bed early. A lot of people will get up. You know, my voice is not this deep. Like in 2 hours from now, it's, you know, so drinking tea and honey. There's a lot of times when people, it's called mouth noise, and it's just kind of this juicy sounding mouth that some people have, and especially a lot of, you know, you either when you're nervous you get dry mouth, or if you're really excited it gets quite so a really green apple is perfect to kind of just get rid of that moisture in your mouth, because there's nothing really worse when you're listening to someone's demo and there's this, I call it a wet sound. So a green apple, if that's something that your mouth does, you know, gets quite salivally, a green apple will get rid of that.
So I'm sure a lot of people here are interested in getting involved in voice acting. We have a lot of great fandom talent, a lot of up-and-coming people who have begun making a transition from the fan world to the professional world. What sort of advice would you offer them?
I mean, I think in any job, you need to have some type of training. You know, it's basic. And the great thing now with, you know, the web is you have all of these endless possibilities. So for anyone that wants to get into animation, of course you have to watch cartoons and love cartoons. you can go on to, we've got, it's the Georgia Strait, but a lot of community papers in the very back will have voiceover lessons. A lot of, we've got a few acting schools in Vancouver, and they're always posting. You know, if you go on to Craigslist, and I think there's a tab that says film and TV, I know it does in Vancouver, but click on that, and a lot of times it might be an independent project. It might be someone who's putting, you know, might be a director who's putting his reel together, or it might be someone that's doing a student film that is looking for someone, and usually those are non-paid, but you can say, well, at the end of it, can I get a clip for my demo? So it doesn't mean that you have to get a BFA in acting, but everyone on my roster on some level either has a theater degree or they've taken improv is great, because a lot of times what they'll do in an animated session, there might be two or three roles that they haven't cast. So what they'll do is when they get to that role, they'd go, Joe, give me your best angry pirate. And then right off the top, you have to come up with that. And then they'd go, Hank, let's hear yours. And then what they'll do is based on the audition in the room, they'll give you that additional role, which of course means more money. So improv is great because it gets your mind thinking on, you know, different characters. And it's really important that in your voice library in your head that you have, you know, 15 or 20 different voices that you can tap on. And make sure that it's not your best Bart Simpson, because there's never going to be a cartoon that comes that'll, you know, on the description that I get, we are looking for someone that sounds like Bart Simpson. They might want those characteristics. So you kind of go, okay, what, you know, they might say Bart Simpson like, so you kind of look at all those things that Bart Simpson does and then just do your own twist to it. You know, contact a lot of the studios. I mean, for those of you that live in Seattle, there are a lot of talent agents in Seattle. All our material is posted on, if you go to voicebank.net, it's a website, and I think there's an icon at the top that lists talent agents, and you can click on that, and it'll say all the talent agents, and then it'll say that the city that they live in. So if you don't live in Seattle, if you live in Portland, you can scroll down and you can see where the agent is located. Then you can click and you can see their address. You can listen to all their demos. So you could go to our website, and we've got a voice library, and you can just listen to animation demos. And you can go onto YouTube, and you know there's so many people that are so gracious that will even sometimes allow you to see them doing a session in their home studio. Contact some of the local recording studios. You can just, you know, Google recording studios in Seattle or whatever city that you make, whatever city that you live in, and you could say, I am, you know, I'm thinking of getting into voiceover first. Do you do any classes? Or if it gets to the point where you have got some characters that you want to lay down, ask them, and most of them, the engineers after hours to make a little extra money, will produce your demo, because they're going to have all the sound effects already. You know, if it's, you know, character running through the woods, they can add that to it. And what you'll want to do is put a demo together. And if you go to our website again, and it'll give you an idea of how the demo should be produced. Before, we used to do, you know, the people would lay down three or four characters. But there's nothing, you know, we're sending these out to really creative people. So when I get a demo, I probably have about 15 seconds of time before, if you haven't sort of drawn me in those 15 seconds, I probably won't listen any further. So just make sure that your strongest material is at the very beginning of the demo. And I'm gonna show you some cool ideas of marketing, because, you know, back in 91, there wasn't the internet. So if someone was interested in getting into voiceover, they would have to send me their material. So this, some of you might not even remember what a cassette take is, but this is for one of my clients. She did that. Her name was Marcy Goldberg. And in this, let me get these, she has three cassette tapes. So one was her commercial, one was her narration, and one was her animation. And then she had sort of four, you know, those small boxes of cereal. Two of them are kind of, you know, serious, I guess, Rice Krispies and Corn Flakes. And then two are fun, Fruit Loops and Cruncheroos. And then on here it says, now fortified with three new voice tapes, more variety, more selection, part of a balanced creative campaign. Start your day right with the crackling freshness of Marcy Goldberg. So I can guarantee you, if this went on anyone's desk, you'd open it. You know, rather than if it was just a cassette with a post-it note that said, you know, her, the name and her phone number. It's creative. She's sending this to creative people. Who knows, maybe you haven't had cereal and you've got some cereal. So this is, I can guarantee you that if you, and of course her material in here warrants how talented she is, you know, and, you know, so there was some cost involved in this, but I can, you know, she sent it to me, I listened to it, and I repped her. So that was back in the day of cassette tapes.
So the creativity definitely has to extend beyond just the voice acting itself. It's all about how you present yourself as a complete individual.
Yeah, and it gives me an idea. You have an idea of the industry. So then we go to DVDs. So then what people would do is they would put their material on a DVD. So this is a client of mine. His name is Matt Ellis. So what he just did is he took, you know, a selfie of his mouth and put it all on here. And then we sat down. We said, okay, well, what can we do? And then we thought, hear me, Matt Ellis. Call me. So he had the great thing with his name that his first initial and last initial does me. So we said, okay, what fun can we have with that? And then you open this up, and then he's got his commercial demo on this side, his animation one, and then he's just some adjectives that describe his voice: young, vibrant, hip, authentic, fresh, engaging, distinct, varied, persuasive, reliable. And then each one of these, again, has me on it. So he's creating a brand, which we all know the Nike swoosh, and there's certain brands that we relate right away to a product. So this is what we wanted to do, is so that, you know, Matt Ellis, me, hear me. Then his business cards have the exact same thing, the little, all the voices with me, then Matt Ellis, and his name. So whenever he goes into a session, whether it's an audition, he hands those out to the various people in the room. Then when you go to his website, again, you see this, so it's this constant branding. I had this one client, his name, what he did is he has a very corporate read. He just took his American Express card, and I think at the time their tagline was, don't leave home without it. Hmm. So then his, he just said, don't go into the studio without him. You know, so look at, you know, things that you can do with your name. We had one girl that she dropped off a loaf of bread. And in her cover letter, it had all adjectives. I need representation. Let's make lots of dough. I need someone to make my career rise.
The puns.
But yeah, you know, and then at the end, it was a great recipe on how to make bread. I had a client who'd produced a demo, and he had sent it out to all the studios, and we weren't getting any bites on it. So I was at the liquor store, and in Vancouver, right next to the cash register, they have all those sort of the small bottles that you get on a plane, and they had, you know, Fireball and Sambuca. And so I called him up and I said, why don't you try this? So I said, go and buy a bunch of them, you know, maybe take three of them and then drop them off at the studios again and go. And we decided, here's a shot if you give me a shot. And by the end of the week, every single studio brought them in. You know, so what is it that you can do? I mean, now, you know, people will just send me an email and, you know, maybe in the subject line, it goes, you know, please listen to my demo. You know, and I will at some point, but it's almost gotten lazy. You know, when you look at some of the examples that people used to have to do to get my attention, now it gets to the point where you can just email me, and then, you know, there'll be an MP3 as an attachment. You know, so what's important is a cover letter. You know, the thing that will drive me crazy if people don't spell my last name right. And it happens, and it's so, I mean, now it's so easy.
It is spelled right on that, right?
Yes, it is.
Oh, thank goodness. Whew.
But so many people do the IE because I before E except after C, which isn't the case in my last name. But it just shows that you haven't done a lot of research. Or if the cover letter is just kind of generic, and what they did is they deleted my name and then put, you know, Carolyn at characters and they deleted her name. I mean, there's so much information that you can find out about me just by putting my name in. You can see the actors that I represent. So you can look on there and say, oh my God, you know, based on the actors you represent, I want to be managed by someone that has, you know, there's all of these things that you can do rather than just, you know, send me an email and say, listen to my demo. So we had the cassette, then we had the DVD.
So attention to detail and also making yourself memorable and unique. Those sound like the guidelines here.
And then this is, you know, this is the most fun I've seen. So it has my client's name on it, Adrian Petru.
Who has been in Pony, if I'm not mistaken. The name, yeah, has he not?
No. He was Iron Man. He's also Ken in the Barbie franchise. So he had just his name, a simple mic in the back. It's his website and my contact info. But the coolest thing is, so it is a USB. So you can see that this is as narrow as a credit card. So you can put this in the computer and I can hear all of his demo material. He also has one for film and TV where it would have his headshots, even his demo, his on-camera demo. But I mean, when you look at this, like, you're going to listen to it because it's just, I'm a nerd when it comes to this kind of technology. and that's part of the game, is what can you do to make me or a potential buyer put this into my computer and hit play? And that is where, you know, you as being creative people, or, you know, talk to your friends and say, hey, what can I do? And I would just say, use the web, look at, see what people have done, look at your name and, you know, what are fun things. One of my clients is Sean Campbell. So we thought Campbell Soup. So then his have all the classic Andy Warhol Campbell Soup tins. And then he's used his voice, the adjectives based on soup for his voice.
Creamy. Yeah. Full of potatoes.
Yeah. Natural flavor. Yeah. Another guy, Dave Marsden, I had. And when he was in Toronto, he was a DJ on a radio station, and his handle was the Mars Bar. So what we thought is, I said, okay, every time that you go into a session, bring in, you know, those little ones you hand out at Halloween. And then stapled on the little Mars bar was my contact information. And he would go there and give it to the receptionist, give it to the engineer, give it to the producers. And one day he went in for an audition. And about half an hour later, the producer calls me up and goes, Dave was in. And I went, yeah. And he goes, you didn't bring a chocolate bar. You know, so if that's the only reason why they're bringing him in is so that they can get that sugar rush, whatever. But it was, you know, kind of a neat thing that you can do. I mean, you can do something like a Starbucks gift card. You know, please grab a coffee and, you know, while you're sipping your coffee, please listen to my demo. And there's nothing wrong with a follow-up email or a phone call. You know, just say, I sent your material. I haven't heard anything. At our agency, we do get back to everyone, and either as a thanks or no thanks. And if I was interested in bringing someone in, then what I would do is I would send you some copy. So I would actually, whether it was for commercial work, I would send you maybe a dozen. When I say copy, it's the actual script for the product. Or if it was for a cartoon, I would send you maybe 8 different characters that I think that you should try. And then when you come to the agency, we'd have a chat. And then I would actually have you go into our recording studio and I would record 3 of the voices that you chose. And I'd give you some direction. And then, you know, after we have the meeting, I'd listen to it, and then I would call you back and let you know if we're going to go further than that.
Now, when you talk about building your sort of brand, how does social media play into that these days? Because I know a lot of your clients are very active on social media, and I think that's one of the great things about our fandom is the fact that we have such warm and accessible members of the cast and crew who are willing to kind of go back and forth with us on Twitter or Facebook or just making themselves available to fans. What are your sort of guidelines there for up and coming voice actors who would like to make progress in the voice acting world? How should they approach the world of social media? Is it better for them to be kind of conservative at the beginning and open up more later on? Are there do's and don'ts? Should they avoid certain topics? What guidelines do you give your clients, if any?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, and that's the great thing with Twitter. I mean, I'm on Twitter, and I think the most, you know, a lot of people are on it to promote themselves. So if you, let's say you get a big gig, to put that out on Twitter. I mean, most of the shows that we work on, you have to sign an NDA. It's a non-disclosure agreement. So you can't disclose the show that you're working on. You can't take a picture of the studio. Like, I couldn't go like this and go, oh my God, you know, great session today, because, you know, the fandom now is going to look and they're going to say, okay, he's in it, she's in it. You know, this must be Project X.
They'll zoom in on the script page. Enhance.
Yeah, exactly.
Celestia said what?
Yeah. So you can't do that. You can say something, oh my God, I'm so excited. I just booked a guest role on a really popular cartoon series. I'll tell you more when it airs. And then a week before it, you can do a countdown. Oh my God, it's going to be on. And then the morning of, once it airs, then you can disclose it. And it's amazing. Like even when for Princess Ember, like we had no idea that that character would explode. But I think after that one episode, the fandom went crazy and I saw it. So then what I did is I knew there was a convention coming up and I said, hey, you know, based on what I'm seeing in Twitter, it would be pretty cool if you were the first one to invite her to a convention. And just so that people know that you're working, you know, I had a great audition for this product, looking forward to more, or if you, just to be out there and to make it look like you're working. And then also through that, you might make some friends that you can then sit down with, you know, hey, let's get together every Sunday and read scripts off of each other. So I think as you get more and more popular and then you find out people that, you know, even in this room, if you know anyone, you could say, hey, I saw you at the agents panel. Is this something that you're interested in doing? And, you know, and start some type of, you know, weekly get together or, you know, hey, can I send you my material and you can critique it and go back and forth.
So the importance of in-person networking and making use of the opportunities like this. So turn to the person on your left, turn to the person. When it comes to booking talent for conventions, just as a point of clarity, who is generally responsible for that? Because you have voice agents, appearance agents, booking agents. You have agents operating in different territories, depending on where the work is. How does that tend to
up until this show, I never booked people at conventions because there just wasn't this level of fandom. There was, you know, some anime conventions, but that is, I kind of looked at that and then I kind of have to look at the return and I don't really have the time to find that market because there's so many anime conventions everywhere. Then when this fandom started and I was getting the phone calls, then I thought, wow, this is, you know, the clients that I represent, I know them very well. I know their wishes. I know what they don't like to do. But then there are some like Claire and Ian were with a previous agent. And at that time they were with, a convention booking agent. So we kind of have an understanding that if you are with a convention booking agent, either they will look after everything, or then I have some clients that might have a convention booking agent because they're really popular, let's say in Stargate or Supernatural, but they'll say, you know, if it has anything to do with My Little Pony, we want Ralph to manage that because he knows my schedule, and then they know that I'm going to get, more than likely, if there's a convention, I will get a call based, you know, I have half of the main six, let alone, you know, some of the show staff that I represent as well. So they know that I'm going to get the call so I can push them to a convention.
What was your sort of general reaction when the fandom exploded as it did and you started getting all of those calls from convention organizers wanting your talent to appear? I mean, how did you first hear about the Brony phenomenon and...
I mean, I think the first one was when we did BronyCon out of New York, and
so that would have been September 2011, January 2012,
yeah.
Around there.
Yeah, and you know, at first it's a bit of caution, as this is a brand, you know, and we have to go at the time we had to go through Hasbro because they wanted to make sure that their brand was being represented properly. And I don't know, I've had no dealings with this person on the other end of the phone. So my, you know, what I have to do is look after my client. I have to make sure that they're paid. I have to make sure that the hotel that they're staying at is up to quality, that they, that there's security for them, that the travel, you know, whether it's the plane, that there's someone at the airport, that they have a handler. So all of those things were new to me. And I had to make sure, that the person that I was dealing with, you know, like, what's your experience? With conventions. I don't know you besides this, you know, a telephone call. So then the first convention I went to was the first ever free because I thought, you know, it was, you know, 3 hours from Vancouver and you know, what is this fandom all about? And, you know, it took me probably about an hour to realize how embracing the fans are. And it was great for voiceover talent because they're never really recognized. You know, it's on-camera talent gets, you know, there's all the award shows for, you know, you look at the Emmys and you look at the Oscars, those are all celebrating on-camera actors. You never have a show that really celebrates the voice of. So it's a great opportunity for the fans of the show to actually meet the voiceover actors, but it also gives the voice actors a chance to talk about their career and to talk about people that have embraced this show so much.
Any particular standout stories of just moments that you've really enjoyed at conventions? I'm going to pass over conventions where things haven't necessarily gone as you might have. People remember Las Pegasus Unicorn.
Yeah.
Less said there, the better.
Yeah. I mean, what I always like, and it was when we were at Fiesta Equestria and Brenda Critchlow, who I represent, who does Zecora.
Folks know Brenda Critchlow. Folks have had the chance. If you ever have the chance to meet Brenda, do so. She is absolutely amazing.
Yeah, she has got the most brightest energy. I remember once we were at a panel and someone came up and wanted her autograph and had a really, really bad body language. And she looked and she said, you know what, you are beautiful. And she gave her a little positivity workshop, like for 10 minutes. This is how you handshake. This is how you... And when that person left, they had the biggest smile on their face. And so when we're at Fiesta and fans were asking questions, she said, you know what, I want to know a little bit about you. And she said, I want to know what lessons that you have learned from the show or any hardships that you got out of. And that was the most, you know, it was a lineup of people. And it amazed me on some of the struggles that people went through and how the show had helped them. And, you know, at the end of it, I think all of our eyes were watering because these people were being so vulnerable, which is really difficult to do amongst a room of people that you really don't know. But to know that in this room, you're not going to be made fun of. And is something I've never seen before.
Well, speaking of a lineup of people, we've got about 25 minutes. So if you have questions for Ralph about the voice acting world, about silly things that Tabitha has done, no. By all means, please line up. Just bear in mind, Ralph can't answer questions about future episodes or projects unless you slip him a Mars bar or something. So go ahead. And if you want to introduce yourself, by all means, do so.
I'm curious, as such a creative guy yourself, how did you end up on Red and you could have gone, grrr?
Well, it's funny. We were looking at our last names, but then it sounded like a law firm because it's Strike Kirshner Dillastone, and we felt so sorry for our receptionist that would have to, you know, Strike Dillastone. And then we thought, okay, what's our web, you know, when you email me, Ralph at strikedillastonekirshner.com, it's like, it would be just painful for me giving that. So then we thought Red from a branding point of view, you know, in Chinese culture, red is prosperity. You think of red carpet. It's catchy from branding, like our business cards are red, our envelopes are red. So there was a lot of reasons, but my partner actually, when we looked at, when they were going Dre, I'm going, well, then that sounds like a hip hop, you know, a hip hop agency. And then when we just read, oh my God, that's so easy to remember. Okay, hey, you're welcome.
Is that mic turned on? There's a little switch. We've got one of our AV people running up to fix it. Wonderful. Thank you very much. Huge round of applause for our AV staff. They've been working hard all weekend. You say red, now I just think of the Red Wedding and the Reigns of Castamere start playing. Sounds like it's on. Cool.
Is it on?
Yep.
Good evening.
Hello.
Yes, I've done, you know, I go around, people see me and they hear my voice and they say, wow, you should do radio, you should do this thing, you should do that, you sound like this. And, you know, I've never actually know how to get into contact with agents, or I don't even know who to talk to about type of stuff. You know, some people say, oh, you need to do radio to get discovered and stuff like that. It's like, I don't even know how to get into radio to begin with to get discovered. So how does discovery actually work when it just comes to just finding people? Do they have to send you something in order for you to find them? Or do you actually sometimes go out and just hear somebody and say, I like the way that guy sounds?
So that is your real voice?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. No, it, I mean,
it's
there's
not some make, some people say that too. They're like, that's not your real voice. Yeah. How can you sound like that? Well, I talk like this all the time. So,
wow. No, there's,
it's
yeah, there's
kind of hard.
He talks like that
yeah.
All the time.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, there's some really, really great qualities to your voice. So, when I first started doing this, I probably was a little bit more active in putting together a roster. Now people in essence find me because they're at a level of their career. I mean, radio, I would say no. If, you know, if we were having this conversation 15, 20 years ago, I would say that's probably a good idea because that was the only thing we really had to listen to. You couldn't, you know, you didn't have Sirius, you didn't have Spotify and all of these internet providers where you can just listen to commercial-free, DJ-free content. What city do you live in?
I live near St. Louis.
And whereabouts is that? What state is that in?
I live on the Illinois side of St. Louis.
Okay. So you're pretty close to Chicago.
Close, maybe, it's about the other side of the state, but
oh, okay.
The long way side of the state.
So, I mean, first thing I would do is, you know, go to, remember, just voicebank.net and just sort of see what agency. Chicago is probably the largest advertising center in North America. So, I mean, that is one thing you have going for you right there.
Chicago's kind of dangerous, though. But
is what? Is dangerous?
It's kind of it's not a great city to live in.
No. Well, I think, you know, there's a lot of, they're called pay-to-play sites, and they're Voices123 and Voices.com, and those are sites that allow you to put up your material for free. So you would put up a bio, you know, whether it's some training you had to do, and then on there you can list your demos it's quite a nominal fee. And then a producer can go on there for free and listen to your demo, and then what they do is they invite you to auditions.
Is that a site they commonly use? Or
yep. And a lot of people that are starting out go to Voices123 or Voices.com.
Voices123 or Voices.com?
Yep. And then
write it down.
And then what you do is you would have to record. So at your house, you'd need to have some type of recording studio. I mean, and now with you know, a lot of my talent will just record through an Apogee mic. It's an Apogee mic, and go to any of your high-end music stores and just say, this is what I want to do. I want to be able to record voiceover in my, you know, if you have GarageBand, then if you've got a Mac, you have GarageBand. Vincent uses an Apogee mic, which he connects into his iPhone, and it has a condenser and everything in it. So from a technical point of view, I really don't know, but I know my people, you know, my clients have gotten to the point where they can send amazing auditions to me remotely. So that would be one of the first things that I would say that you would do is, you know, find out a way of recording your voice. Then right away when I hear you, I can see narration. You know, when you look at Discovery Channel and all of these A&E networks. So pick up something like a National Geographic, because you're going to have the stories written in there. So, you know, maybe find one on tourism in Hawaii and maybe read a paragraph of that. And then, you know,
so for
pollution in China.
I should read National Geographic magazine?
I would say to lay something down. Like if you said, okay, what am I going to put on my demo? And for, let's say, for your narration demo, that is what I do. Is what anyone would want to hear is you reading for about 30 seconds to get an idea of your style of voice. And you've got a really great textured voice for that.
Thank you.
Then you would post that on a Voices123, Voices.com. And then what happens is a producer can listen to that. And then what they would do is they would send you a script to audition for. And you can do that all from your home. And if it got to the point where it was a large campaign, then you know, look and see what studios are even close to the city that you live in that you could possibly get a deal going where you could go in there and use their equipment for a nominal fee.
Yeah, I haven't had any schooling or anything like that, but I have played Dungeons & Dragons as a DM, and I've voiced over 300 characters at this point, mostly uniquely. But
And do you have clips of those voices that you recorded?
Yes, I recorded every single one of them.
Yeah, so that as well you could, you know, so let's say, you know, narration is what I can see, but then also do clips of that for an animation demo. And then I would start on those websites. And then what would happen is, let's say you end up getting some gigs on from Voices123 or Voices.com. Then at that point, I would contact an agent and say, even if you got a gig and you said, you know, I really don't know how to negotiate this, I'm wondering if you could perhaps negotiate this on my behalf. And you could start a relationship that way. I've had people do that where they've got a really large gig and say, you know what, I have no idea what I should be paid for that. can you negotiate this on my behalf?
Sounds like you're off to a good start there.
Thank you very much.
Lots of good advice. Thank you very much.
Hey, you're welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
Just going to do one of these here. Hi, I'm Zach. So as a Canadian myself and located in Canada, specifically the kind of middle of nowhere but willing to move kind of thing, you mentioned that a lot of your clientele have, you know, bachelor's of fine arts and acting degrees and especially background in theater. So for, per se, getting into the field, and I, you know, the demo being a huge part of that, is education substantially in those, like, finance, or not financing,
the arts.
Yeah, the arts. Is that a hugely important thing? And if so, what would you recommend?
I mean, because you look at my training has nothing to do with what I did, but there's certain things that I learned in university that you can apply to so many different levels of your life. But I would say, you know, even community theater, it's a huge commitment to do, you know, 4 years and get a BFA program. But, you know, see what other, like On the Mic is a, it's like a voiceover school in Vancouver that a lot of the teachers work a lot. Michael Dangerfield, Andrea teaches there, Marika teaches there. So look and see, and that's a great resource because, again, they're going to share all of this sort of knowledge with you, you know, agents in town, recording studios in town, and then the people that are taking that class with you, then all of a sudden you can start building a relationship. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you know, watch cartoons, you know, even, you know, turn the volume off and see what voice you can come up with. If you're interested in doing TV commercials, do the same thing. Mm-hmm. And all of that copy that you can, since you're using it for your demo, there's no copyright infringement on that.
Yeah, so you can kind of do whatever you like.
Yeah, and then like I said, go to you know, Craigslist and go to that film and TV, and there's so many people that post things, especially with Vancouver Film School, that are looking for, whether it's, you know, you might say, well, on-camera acting isn't something that I really want to do, but it's going to build your confidence talking in front of people.
Of course.
There's a lot of people that do shorts, like Emily Carr has a digital, you know, and say maybe there's someone that wants a voice for their 1.5 digital movie. You know, and just start getting that kind of work under your belt.
Okay. Yeah, because after this, I'm driving right back up to Vancouver and spending about 2.5 weeks looking at different schools in the areas and what they're going to be having. So, I mean, this is...
Yeah, definitely I would look at On the Mic, because if voice is something that you're focused on, they have a great reputation and a lot of their students work.
Okay. Well, sweet. Thank you very much.
Hey, you're welcome.
Hello, my name is Nathan.
Hello there.
You've given a lot of great information about where to kind of search for talent agents for representation. But given the hypothetical that you're just putting a lot of stuff out on YouTube and you get contacted by an agency, what are some red flags that we should be on the lookout that this might be a scam?
That's a great question.
Well, I mean, the easy thing for us, I'm pretty sure it happens in the U.S. as well. All talent agents in British Columbia have to be licensed. So that would be the first thing. So there's an ethics that, and I was on the board with our provincial government to come up with ethics for a talent agency. So the amount of commission that we can charge. You know, the only way that I make money is when you make money. Hmm. So there can't be, there's, you know, before there are agencies, I'd say, you know, like I need, you know, a $50 post-data check for a year. It's like, well, no. So if you, and I'm pretty sure that in the United States, you SAG, which is your actors union, regulates agencies. So ask if you're licensed or if you are recognized by SAG. That would be one of the first things. No money should ever be paid up front. I mean, that is the big red flag, you know. Courier costs, all of those things. And that's what they say. It's courier costs, long distance. Well, that's the cost of doing business. You know, yes, I courier out a lot of things. But eventually when you get a gig, then I'm getting commission from that. So find out what the commission structure is. If there's any costs up front, more than likely they're going to have you sign a contract and, make sure you look at it, you know, clearly and look at all the terms. It's not a matter of you having to go to a lawyer, but you know, if there's some, issues in the contract, then highlight them and call the agent and said, I don't know what this wording exactly means. Can you explain it to me? But those would be sort of things that I would look out for.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Before the next question, you mentioned union membership. What is the usual sort of timeline or the order of events in gaining representation, becoming a member of a union? Which tends to sort of happen first? What needs to happen for one to lead to the other?
Like if someone drops off their demo and they say, you know, first I'll look at their resume and I can say, wow, they've worked a lot. If it's someone new that has a really great demo, I will look and see if they're a union member. And a union member sort of just gives you an idea of their professional qualifications, because when you work on a union job, so let's say you got a job on My Little Pony, you would get a union credit, and you need 3 credits to get full membership. And once you have full membership in the union, then, you know, there's, you know, insurance and retirement. So I have taken people on that were non-members of the union, because I saw that there was some talent. There really isn't a order on, you know, if someone's a full member, then I'm kind of going, okay, they've worked in front of the camera. They kind of know mic technique. They kind of know what happens when they go into a room. If someone has approached me, let's say they've just graduated from a theater school and they do their demo, then what I would do is before they go into a studio, I would sort of give them a studio etiquette 101 lesson on what to expect and some of the jargon that they might hear that the director will say that they might not be familiar with. But I also encourage them when they go into the room, they can go up to the director and say, you know what, this is my first gig. So I just, you know, just so you know, I might be a little looking at you for some guidance. And 99% of the time, the director will say, oh my God, thanks for letting me know. And they'll explain what they want. So that the person doesn't feel uncomfortable.
And it makes the director's job easier versus the director not knowing that this is a new actor and
getting frustrated.
What's wrong with this person? Yeah. Why aren't they doing this? Why don't they use this lingo and that lingo?
Yeah, and you're being honest, and then they're going to appreciate that. They're going to take a little bit more. They're going to have a little bit more patience if you don't know all the proper jargon.
Next question, then.
Hello, my name is Alex.
Hey, Alex.
As an agent, have you ever had some doubts in your judgment, or there were some moments where you weren't sure what to do?
I have made some bad choices with, you know, someone that I heard that I thought, oh my God, I think that they're really going to do well. And they didn't. And, you know, and it's just, you know, we have a pleasant meeting. It's, you know, we both tried, but it's probably best that you know, find energy elsewhere. But yeah, there are situations. There's a perfect example with, I had people that were at Las Pegasus. Again, that was, and there were some red flags that came up that I didn't listen to my gut, which it was quite funny because after that nightmare, I remember, I think it was the weekend, the following week, I got the first call from Bob from Nightmare Nights, who's an awesome guy. And I think there's a few times I just, you know, I saw, you know, this guy again, I said, put him into voicemail. And it was just like, I had that weekend was so stressful. The last thing I wanted to do was talk to another person that wanted to put on one of these conventions, which thankfully, you know, Bob was persistent and, you know, he's a top notch guy and he knows what he's doing. But, you know, there have been situations where, you know, I should have gone with my gut and I didn't.
But sort of learn from that and roll with the punches and keep moving forward.
And, you know, and this whole convention thing was new. So, you know, it was a matter of tightening up the contract, making sure that I had funds in advance before my talent went. And then once we build a relationship, then we can sort of change those parameters. But, you know, if I don't know you, I need to have that money in my account before my client gets on the plane. So.
Thank you.
Hey, you're welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, name is Justin, and the BronyCon I actually work for has worked with you before, the Grand Brony Gala out in Florida.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I've actually had a couple of private sessions with people of MLP, such as one of yours, Peter New and Kathy Westlock, and even taking scene study courses at the Burt Reynolds Institute for Film and Theater back in Florida where I live. But one thing I'm kind of struggling to figure out is knowing when you're actually voice acting or just putting on a goofy voice. Any idea how you can tell the difference?
I think a lot of times when you, like a Vincent or an Andrea or Tabitha, they are so confident. I think the confidence comes through. So I don't think there's really is this a funny voice or if it's voice acting? I think they're almost, it's going to be a funny voice that you're acting. So I think you just have to be really confident with your choice. And, you know, if it almost ends up that it's just another part of you, then that's the best scenario, because you don't even have to think about the acting because you're so comfortable with this character that you've created.
Yeah, when I had a private session with Peter, I showed him a character I did for a friend's series and got a response I wasn't expecting, saying he sounded more like a goofy voice, but I don't know. I'm not the best. I'm my own worst critic, is what I'm saying.
I think we all are. You know, listen, you know, if I listen to my voice on a tape recorder, or if I listen to this afterwards, I'm going, there's no way I sound like this. But you really have to make sure that whatever voice you do choose, that you can extend that for a 4-hour session. Mm-hmm. And then think, if you get the lead in it and you end up doing 26 episodes, you know, so that's for anyone that's developing a voice. You know, a perfect example is, you look at Daffy Duck. You know, anyone can probably do that for about 8 seconds, but it is just so guttural on your voice. Could you do that for a 4-hour session? So really make sure that whatever voice you do come up with, you can extend it over that period of time. And being able to go from voice A to voice B without any of the characteristics of that one voice coming through in the other. So a lot of the times when Andrea, or even Tabitha, I mean, when I watch a session and she goes from Rarity to photo finish to Granny Smith, I mean, it's uncanny on how she can do it. I mean, she can be having a conversation with herself, and depending on who the actor is, sometimes they'll just all the Granny lines, and then they'll cut and paste them in. But in the case of Tabitha, it can be Granny Smith talking to Rarity, talking to photo finish on a page, and Tabitha is going those characters, and none of them do you hear, oh, I hear a bit of Granny Smith in Rarity, or I hear a bit of photo finish in. So really making sure that your voices can distinctly sound different, and that you can maintain that if you were having a conversation back and forth.
Okay. And tangentially, the fact that you're taking on board sort of constructive criticism from people in the know and considering it as intently as you are, I take that. I mean, I'm just a random fan, but I would take that as a positive sign that you're interested in developing things further. So
yeah, I'm stepping into a world that I don't know much about, so it's best to listen to the instructor. And I've trusted the people that I've worked with thus far. But it gets a little confusing when I get one piece of advice from Peter, but then I get something completely different from Kathy.
The frustrating thing that's always going to happen.
Yeah.
Is that you're going to go into a session, it's going to be a different director, it's like if I gave you a pasta dish and I said, can you describe the flavors that you're tasting? And then I would do it, I can guarantee you we probably would not taste the same thing. And that's what you're going to have. You're going to go into a session and a director is going to give you, he's going to say, you sound, like it happens so often with some of my women, you sound way too much like a Valley Girl. And then she'll go into a session with another director and they're saying, you don't sound the exact same voice print. And they say, you need to sound more like a Valley Girl. So it's kind of like, go with the punches and just realize that everyone has, that you're being creative and everyone has different, you might like this piece of art and I like this. You like Kanye West and I like Taylor Swift. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of that we all are different people, and just being able to kind of, as long as you're learning something from it, then I think that you're only going to benefit.
And coming into it with humility as well, thinking that you're God's gift to voice acting, and no, you're not going to listen to these people. You know what you're doing, and to hell with their advice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of times
the attitudes there.
One out of 10 gigs, you're a good batting average, and I could not, I couldn't do that. And a lot of times, there's been situations where my clients have done like 4 episodes of a series, and then they've taken it and then they've started putting it to picture. So what happens first is they record the voice, and then the voice is sent to the animation house, and then they start creating the images. And there's been some situations after 4 episodes when they've taken the voice and put it to the image, they say, that voice just doesn't work with that image. And they say, we're going to recast. So you think you have 26 episodes, you've got, so first financially you're thinking, okay, I'm good for the year. And then 4 episodes in, they say, it's just not working. So then I have to, I was the bearer of the good news, and then I have to call up and those are just painful conversations to have.
Ouch.
But to be able to not take that personal,
mm-hmm.
Where you'll go in for a callback, and then it's just between the two of you, and then they'll bring you in again. I had one of my clients just booked a cartoon series after 8 callbacks. So, you know, they start off, you know, maybe hearing 50 people, then they narrow it down to 20, then they narrow it down to 2, and they kept on bringing in Valent and the other actor. And, you know, the last time he went, he says, okay, I was in the studio for about 25 minutes, and the actor before me was in there for 5 minutes. He says, so I'm thinking that's looking good. And he ended up getting the gig. But, you know, just that constant, that carrot dangling, and then, you know, you didn't get it. And then, you know, you get a phone call, and maybe after that disappointing news, you have an audition an hour later. So you just have to forget that. You know, there's a great line. It's called Voice is the Mirror of the Mind. You know, what's ever happening in here, we have a tendency to spill it out. I've got a client who is an AA member. For obvious reasons, I won't send him out for beer ads. Mm-hmm. But even if I dangled that carrot and said, you know, you can make, you know, $50,000 on this, I can guarantee you that he would not get that gig, because everything, you know, what he's gone through is going to come through in his delivery. Mm-hmm. So it's really important too, for commercials. I had a client who was the voice of McDonald's, and after a year, she made a lot of money. She says, you know what? I'm vegan. And I just don't feel comfortable auditioning for this company for many reasons. So when they went to renew her contract, I just said, you know, like, we've got a conflict. You know, she's working now for another fast food chain, and she can't work for you. I'm not going to disclose her personal point of view, but if there's something that you really don't believe in, then just, you know, go to your agent, and I'm going to appreciate it. And if you say, you know what, I don't want to do a political ads are a perfect example, mm-hmm. where you might say, you know what, I don't vote this way, so I'd rather not go into the studio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. It's great finally meeting you.
Hey, you're welcome.
And I think we have time for one more question, which is great because we have one more question.
You've had wonderfully thoughtful answers. I appreciate that.
Hey, I'm glad that you
I'm wondering if you could take us back to maybe a conversation you had with the chairs of this convention. Like, how do they coordinate with you with who you think is a good fit for the next Everfree, that kind of thing? Like, how does that first conversation work when you're planning on who could come?
I mean, I guess with the first one they were looking at, they wanted to get as many of the main six in. And then, you know, for any convention, you know, the following year, they're probably not going to bring the same people year two, because a lot of the fans are going to, you know, be coming, whether it's from Seattle or areas nearby that are, well, I've already seen Tabitha and Andrea. So we kind of look and see who you saw the previous year. There's usually a theme. You know, sometimes it's, I think one year it was Gilda. You know, it was Gilda and did
I think there was a year where all the CMC were present.
Yeah, Cutie Mark Crusaders were here. John Delancey, I think they once had the villains. I think one year the villains of MLP. So they kind of look at a theme, and then based on that, like, let's say if there was a singing one, then I'd suggest, well, bring down Daniel and maybe Kazumi and Shannon and you know, the people that are singing on the show, Rebecca, you know, so they kind of give me an idea of what the theme is. And then based on that, I would suggest the voices.
So they came to you with the theme that they wanted?
Yep.
Okay, cool.
I think Everfree is a little bit more, you know, and I think the conventions that are in a year two or year three and a year four, they're going to try to keep it interesting for the fandom and not bring, you know, there's always the main six that everyone loves seeing, but, you know, some of the, and a lot of times we don't know which characters that the fans love. Like, a perfect example was when Allie did Amber. Mm-hmm. Like, that just, and you know, and then I sometimes, because I know what's happening in the season that we're recording, so I might just bait them a little bit and say, I think it might be a good idea that you bring so-and-so, because I know by the time the convention airs, there's a huge arc on what this character is going to do. So if I have a good relationship with a con chair, I'm going to say, trust me, I think you should bring so-and-so because something big's happening this season.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And unless there are any further questions, I believe, oh yep, it's 11:01, so that will wrap it up for us. Huge round of applause, please, for Agent Extraordinaire, Mr. Ralph Strike. And I believe some of your clients are signing autographs in the next room down right about now.
One last thing I'm just going to offer for anyone. If you go onto our website, of course, my email address is there. Please don't hesitate if you ever have a question, or even if you produced a demo and you just want my point of view. Being in Canada, I cannot represent anyone in the United States, because to work under our collective agreement, you have to be a Canadian citizen or landed in Canada. So that's something I can't do, but I'd be more than happy to, for example, the gentleman there, if you did something, I could say, you know, I think you need to do this, or you should tweak it or make it shorter. I mean, my contact information is on the website, and I'd be more than happy to just go to www.red. Just, yeah, if you Google redmanagement.com, management, just do Red Management Vancouver, and all the information, my contact information, will be in there. All right. Hey, you're welcome.
Ralph Strike of Red Talent Management.